interested in learning computational techniques, this workshop will avail participants the chance to explore basic in silico methods aimed at reducing time and cost without compromising effectiveness. I wish you all an exciting and knowledge-filled day. Thank you and God bless.
So I want you to be interested, inform your staff to be here, those in Krishna, let us be here, Cobans and Corners, to help you in your research and make a decision that at the end of this workshop, you must publish a paper based on blocking. Are you with me? And you must apply it in your research. Is that okay? Very, very important. Thank you very much and God bless you.
Before you find out molecular blocking, there are two things that are highly needed. The first one is the protein of interest. Let's assume you are working on diabetes, and we have different drug targets in diabetes. We have adrenal reductase, we have insulin receptor, and the like. We have a number of them. So you must first and foremost do your own work. What do I want to do? Am I working? If I'm working on diabetes, I should have a target. So that target is the protein that will be retrieved from the protein data bank. So the next step is the compound. Now you are targeting the protein that is implicated in the pathogenesis of diabetes. Now what you want to use? What you want to use to target it? And in this case, it is the compound, which also known as ligand. Let's assume that we want to work on COVID-19, and we have different drug prime targets. And one of such is the three C-like proteins of SARS-CoV-2. And now, before you proceed, note you must have had the thought or the mind of using this target. So you can now, before you go online to retrieve the protein, you can as well go through some articles on it. So you can go through some articles online, you can go through Google Scholar and the likes. Then after you identify some of the articles, then you can go through them. Then you can look for the protein data bank, the ID they use for that particular study.
When they are introduced, it may not just be that they will inhibit, they are also able to also activate it. Especially when I won't talk about that too much today because you are looking at the inhibitory aspect. And one of the things that may not be very known as far as now is concerned is that computer may not be able to tell you that this thing is going to activate it or it's going to inhibit it. So that's one of the limitations of computer drugs. And you have to check it to know that it is inhibiting it. So, what I'm saying is that your drug or your molecule must be able to either activate, if it's a protein that needs activation to find expression of before the whole process will actually come to success, you will need a compound that will be able to activate it. And if it's a compound that will need to inhibit it, it must do that same work as well.
If you use rats in silico or use rats in the wet lab, you should also use rats in the in silico. Now, Mark Mommy was the professor, was talking about Drosophila. We actually did a little work on Drosophila melanogaster, and we used it as the model for disease, having known that the gene is having about 70 to 80% proteins, that are responsible for disease in human. Not as though the whole genome is 80% similar to that of human, but some specific genes that are responsible for disease condition in human are also replicated in the soul in Drosophila. So what we did is to get the Drosophila, use it as human, as model, as in vitro, I mean in vivo rather, and use that same one in silico so that the results can tell If you use it in vitro, when you go into something as a silico, you will get two different results. Because the structure of the protein may not be exactly the same.
When you do docking, there's something they call validation. You can even do it before your docking to validate your docking program. To see, you can use an already established inhibitor that maybe the experimental study has already been done. You can start with that, or you can run it along with your docking, so that you already know, we have all the knowledge, or maybe some knowledge about the binding sites, and then we have a knowledge about the experimental activity of that compound. So you can start with that to see. In fact, sometimes when you even download your protein from PDB, it can come with, sometimes it shows you, it comes with ligands. So you can make use of that ligand. That one has already been validated. If what you are doing, you are getting the same thing as what has already been validated, then you can begin to assume that what you are doing is probably correct.
The goal of the workshop basically is to train scientists on how to discover and then design drugs that can be of therapeutic use, even in their homes, without going to the labs. And then that way they can save time and cost and still not compromise effectiveness. The truth is, we need to empower ourselves as this capacity building. We need to train the trainers. When we train, we the lecturers, we train ourselves, and we know, because I mean, what we want to teach our students, we also are not so equipped with enough knowledge. So we need to get the knowledge, acquire the knowledge, train ourselves, and then we begin to organize some other local session.
We are just beginning, really. We're just beginning. It's possible for us to have people who biochemists or pharmacologists or pharmacists and so on, chemists especially, it will be a much better aspect of the workshop. It is important that those who are explaining things to us, who are knowledgeable in the area of science, various areas of science, should also be able to transmit their instructions to us in a way that everything will blend. They are doing a wonderful job, but some of the explanations which we are having, if a chemist were, for example, to handle it, a pure chemist, it would be a different thing. But then that chemist who would handle it is not knowledgeable in computer work. So I think it will be important if, for example, we can have a blend of courses which combine the life sciences and computer, like informatics and so on, to be able to handle this aspect of the workshop.
Computer-aided drug design is actually aimed at moving researchers from the conventional way of research into the modern way of research, especially in the aspect of designing drug. In previous years, to design a drug may take not less than 10 to 25 years before you can get it. You actually have to do a lot of experimental studies using animal models or using a lot of cell culture, cell lines, and a lot of other means before you can actually get a drug. And it is a very expensive research, and a lot of work need to be put in place, human power, money. It has been reported that before you can get a single drug, you have to spend about $800 million to $1 billion before you can get it. But with the aid of computer-aided drug design, which we are actually currently pushing forth to the nation at Christian University here, we know that within few hours, compounds about 1,000 to 100,000 and lots can actually be screened be using computers. Just your simple computer can do a lot of work without going to the lab. So this aspect is to move researchers from the conventional way into the new way.
There is lots to benefit from here, and that's why I'm here. Having we are in a jet age, actually, and research has been transformed with the aid of computers. So it will take my research outputs from a dragging level to with a speed of light. Let me put it that way, because traditionally, to get a good result from the lab take a longer time. But coupling laboratory work with a computer will make research more easier and faster to get good discovery. We are part of the